Well, hello. It's good to be here with you all today. We're going to continue our Live Better series today. And today we're going to be talking about a really important topic that I think you'll find meaningful, and I hope you'll find it helpful as well. In today's class, we're going to be continuing the theme, and I want you to think about this as I say it, okay? The theme for all of our classes is, I can live a vital and meaningful life, okay? So we're all here and we're affirming that I can live a vital life, which means to be really alive, and the life that I live can have meaning. It has meaning to me and it can have meaning in general because who we are makes a difference in how we conduct ourselves, that we're making a positive difference in the world. So living a vital life and living a meaningful life is the general theme for all of our classes. And then in today's class specifically, we're going to be talking about building resiliency and stress hardiness. And resiliency means to be strong like a really strong tree where our roots go down into the ground, and when a big wind comes up, we're strong enough to take that wind, and we're also flexible enough to take that wind as well. That's what resiliency is. And then stress hardiness means we're strong enough to deal with the stresses of life. And we all know that if you're alive, you're going to have stress in your life. We're going to have stress, aren't we? So stress hardiness is, rather than being overwhelmed by the stress in life, to be strong enough to deal with the stress that life brings us, whether that's physical or mental or emotional or spiritual or social stress. Whatever the stressors are, we're strong enough to deal with it because we've developed some skills to deal with life stress, and we're also developing some mastery for how we make our way in the world. Another important element as we begin today's talk, you guys, just think about your own life. Now, I know many of you here in our audience, some of you might have a history, 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 years of dealing with anxiety or with depression or with bipolar disorder or schizophrenia or schizoaffective disorder. Or maybe you have a dual disorder, which means you have that stuff, plus you might have alcohol or drug abuse on top of that. And I know some of you also, for 10 or 20 or 30 years, have been dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder. So one of the key things to share with you today is, in this journey of recovery, in your being healthy and well, and being the best person, the strongest person that you can be, is that this topic of resiliency and stress hardiness, it's really the foundation of recovery. These things that we're talking about today, as we're dealing with our anxiety, our depression, our PTSD, our co-occurring disorder, that having a good stress management program is the foundation of recovery. All the rest of our recovery is built on this foundation of how well am I taking care of myself physically, how well mentally, how well emotionally, spiritually, existentially. What is my program of recovery? Am I being conscientious in taking good care of myself? And that takes us to another important life theme, and that is self-care and self-responsibility. So as you guys know, recovery is built on I am responsible for the quality of my life. I'm responsible for the direction of my life, and I'm responsible for the quality of my life. So just think about that for a minute, huh? That as we are walking on this road or this journey of recovery, to be successful, we all need to say, my recovery is not dependent on other people, places, or things. It's really dependent on my willingness to take responsibility for my life, to be aware and be awake of who I am and what's going on in my life, and to take responsibility for what I do with my life. So along with self-responsibility, Another key idea is self-care. So today we're going to be talking about coming up with your own self-care plans. What are you going to do to take care of yourself? Now, I know you're already doing some of these things, and so every time we talk about things that you are doing, you want to put a gold star next to your heart or next to your name. That, yeah, you go, yeah, I'm already doing that. I'm doing that to take good care of myself. So self-care in terms of what you're already doing. But then I also hope that as we're walking through the class today, you're going to come up with one or two or three other ideas. Some things where you say, you know what, that sounds really good. That's something I'm going to start doing to take good care of myself. So this idea of taking good care of myself, it kind of goes along with self-responsibility. So self-care is similar to self-love, huh? One of the things that's important for us to walk this road of recovery is to say, I need to love myself. I need to take good care of myself. How do I know if I love myself? The way we know that is, am I taking good care of myself? Am I doing the things that a healthy person does to take care of myself physically or mentally, emotionally or spiritually? And we're going to be examining those things today, and I'm going to be asking you to check in with yourself and say, how am I doing with this? Am I taking good care of myself in this area? Am I taking good care of myself in that area? And if you are, again, great, good for you. But if you see an area where you can grow in or you can start to do that, you want to check that off and say, you know what, I want to start doing that. Now, as we're looking at resiliency and stress hardiness, as we usually do, we're going to be doing that within the paradigm of acceptance and commitment therapy. And those of you that have been in the class before, and many of you have, this paradigm of acceptance and commitment therapy. And let's go through these basics real quick. That's on your worksheet there. So one of the things, this is the way we started off our class. The idea of the bluebird of happiness, that I can live a vital and meaningful life. And that is such good news for those of us who have suffered. We have really suffered with depression or anxiety or PTSD or a co-occurring disorder or schizophrenia or schizoaffective disorder, to say, I can have my disorder without my disorder having me. I may have a diagnosis of this or that or this or that, and though I can still live a vital and meaningful life. That's the bluebird of happiness. The other thing that's real important then as we follow along with that, what's next is the pair of glasses. That we all realize I need to have a new pair of glasses, which means I need to start taking a look at life in a different way. So just think about that for a minute, okay? Are you willing today to continue to start looking at your life in a different way? Maybe a different way of looking at yourself, or a different way of looking at your family, or your friends, or recovery, or medications, or all these different things that we're going to be talking about. Looking at them in a different way. The next thing that we want to take a look at is the Chinese finger trap, which is, we know from the Chinese finger trap, when we struggle against it, we trap ourselves, don't we? Yeah. And when we accept it and we relax into it, then we free ourselves up. And so the idea of the Chinese finger trap is, we start off with resiliency and stress management by accepting ourselves as we are. So think about that for a minute right now. Are you accepting yourself as you are right now? Or at least are you willing to do that? Next, are you accepting other people, places, and things the way they are? And are you accepting life the way it is? Accepting life on life's terms. So the idea of radical acceptance with the Chinese finger trap. Now, as we accept ourselves in life, the next thing we're going to do is let this beach ball come up. We've talked in other classes, haven't we, about how when difficult things come up in life, we push that beach ball underwater and say, I don't want to deal with that thought. I don't want to deal with that feeling. I'm going to push it underwater so I don't have to deal with it. But what happens in the long run is we exhaust ourselves, and then we get into maladaptive coping with oversleeping, hiding under the covers, alcohol or drugs, taking our medications in the wrong way, gambling. So to be healthy now, to be resilient, we want to have the courage to let that beach ball come up. Let that beach ball come up and say, you know what? Even though I don't feel comfortable with these thoughts and feelings, I'm going to let them come up. And in a mindful way, I'm going to tolerate them. And if we're having trouble tolerating them, this is where things like journaling comes in, or having someone to talk to, like a mentor or a therapist or a counselor. And now, having accomplished these things, then up in the upper right-hand corner, the next step in living a meaningful and vital life is to say, one, two, three. One, two, three. What are the one, two, three things that are really most important to me in terms of my health and happiness? Think about that real quickly, okay? We're going to talk about it more in class, but right now, can you identify what's most important to you in your life right now, today? Can you identify a second thing that's really important to you in your heart? Not what somebody else thinks is important, but what do you think is important, feel is important? And then thirdly, what's another thing that's really important to you? So this is the foundation for our recovery, that I can live a vital life. I need a new perspective. I need to accept what is as it is. I need to let my thoughts and feelings emerge and develop and just come up and not be afraid of my thoughts and feelings. And then identify what's really important to me. Now that we've got this perspective on our recovery, let's go ahead and take a look at stress for a minute. And you'll see under number one, there's a long list of stuff there, and we're going to walk through that, and I want you to circle what symptoms of stress you've had in the last couple of weeks. So I'm going to ask you to think about your life and say, well, has this been going on or not? Now, again, this is not to put ourselves down or to judge ourselves, but one of the things that's important, you guys, when we're having stress symptoms, we want to be able to listen to them. That's why being mindful is so important. And to be mindful means to be awake and listening to my body, listening to my mind. What is my life telling me? Because if we're having a lot of stress symptoms and they're really strong, they're really intense, it's trying to tell us, hey, something's out of whack here. You need to do something to change your life. Something's going on here. But if we're not listening to it, if we're pushing the beach ball underwater, if we're getting high or getting loaded or pulling the covers over our head, if we're out of touch with our lives, we're not going to listen to these symptoms, and we're going to get sicker and sicker and sicker. And then we have a breakdown, either a physical breakdown or a mental or emotional breakdown. And we don't want that to happen, do we, you guys? So let's go through this list of stress symptoms. And as we do, identify in the last couple of weeks which ones you've had. Have you had headaches, back pain, indigestion, a racing heartbeat, stomach ache, restlessness? Have you had sleep problems, either insomnia where you can't go to sleep, or you can only sleep for a couple of hours and then you wake up and you can't go back to sleep, or another sleep problem is like when we're really depressed and we're sleeping 14 or 16 hours a day? Have you had dizziness? Have you been forgetful? Have you been worrying a lot? Have you had racing thoughts? Have you been unable to make decisions? Have you had trouble thinking clearly? Your thoughts feel really muddled. Have you been grinding your teeth? Have you been really critical of other people? Have you been abusing alcohol or drugs or trying to escape your feelings through gambling? Have you been crying a lot? Have you been angry quite frequently? Have you been feeling overwhelmed, like life is just up to here, it's like I can't take it anymore? Have you been feeling bored or feeling like your life doesn't have any meaning? So that list that we just went through here, you guys, those are some of the primary symptoms of stress in our lives as human beings. And so now if we're alive, every day we're going to have some of these, okay? Every day we're going to have some of these. When these become a problem, though, and you would say, holy mackerel, I think there's a problem here. It would be a problem if you circled a whole bunch of these and they were really intense and they've lasted for a long time. So like if I've had racing thoughts and I've been worried and I've got stomach problems and headaches and I'm really mad at people for one or two or three weeks and all this is going on for a long time, or I've relapsed and I'm drinking again, or I'm using drugs again, or I'm gambling again, or I'm hiding out in my apartment or in my house and I don't want to be involved in life, and that's gone on, it's really intense, and it's gone on for one or two or three weeks. Before things get worse, I want to say, wait a minute, there's a problem here. I'm having a problem here. I need to do something. I need to intervene in my life. And we're going to be talking about what those things are. So having circled, and this, by circling this, you've basically just done an assessment of your life. So question number two says, how do you assess your stress? Are you concerned? So just check in with yourself right now and say, am I concerned about my level of stress? Am I doing okay, or do I seem to be stressed out? So that's your own personal evaluation, okay? Okay, very good, you guys, very good. Let's go to question number three. In question number three, it takes us to the stress iceberg. And so, like with every iceberg, there's a part that's above water and there's a part that's below water. Now, the part above water, it's about 20 or 30%, probably about 30%. That's the part that we see. So the above part of an iceberg, when we're talking about stress, are the symptoms we just went through. That's what SX stands for. That stands for symptoms. So our symptoms, that list we just went through, that's what's at the top of the list. Those are the things that make us feel bad. Those are our symptoms. However, there's 70% under the water, what we don't see. So we want to ask ourselves, what's under the water? And when we say what's under the water, what we're also saying is, what is causing my stress? Because if we're going to deal with our stress, we have to deal with what causes it. That's where sometimes we make a mistake or we can be disappointed. If we're feeling some of these symptoms and we go to our primary care physician or we go to our nurse practitioner or our doctor and we just want a medication to make all that go away, we're just covering up our stress. And we're really not dealing with it, which means my life really isn't getting better. I'm taking this medication that dulls me out and it removes my physical or mental or emotional pain, but my life isn't changing, is it? And we're here because we want to change our lives. And by changing our lives, we will have less distress. We will be more vital. Our lives will be more meaningful. So we want to say, what the heck is causing this stress? What's underneath these symptoms? What are the causes? So number three here says, what's causing our stress? Am I grieving, or have I lost someone or something important in my life? Now again, that might be in the last week or two or the last month or two. However, many of us with depression or anxiety or other problems, we talked earlier about pushing that beach ball underwater, didn't we? Many people that I've counseled over the years, they'll come in and they'll say, I want to deal with life. I'm ready to talk about things that have bothered me in the last year or for 20 or 30 years. And so they let that beach ball up And one of the top ones that we always see is grief and loss. And they'll start talking about losses that they had, separation or divorce for themselves in their life, or maybe their parents were separated or divorced, people who have died, people who have moved away, people that won't have anything to do with us anymore, careers that are lost, some functioning, some of our physical health functioning, some of our mental health functioning has been lost. Those are all grief and loss issues, aren't they, you guys? And so, again, if we don't talk about those and deal with those in therapy and in our life, that stuff will eat our lunch, won't it? It'll eat us up. So we want to ask ourselves, is that causing my stress in my life today? Something that happened 5 or 10 or 20 or 30 years ago that I've never dealt with. What about family relationships? Are there problems in your family that are stressful to you and it's really causing you physical or mental or emotional distress? And the first thing is to identify it, and then the next question is, what am I going to do about it? We'll be talking about that later. The next area is finances. Think about this for a minute. Where are you at with your finances? What is your financial health? Do you have the finances in your life to take care of your basic daily needs or not? What is that stressor in your life, and what do you need to do to deal with that stressor? Do you have certain physical health or mental or emotional health concerns? And are you tending to your health? Are you, again, we talked earlier about self-care and personal responsibility. If we have health concerns, but we're not doing everything we can do to take care of our health, we're going to feel stressed out about that, aren't we, you guys? What about trusting other people? Do you trust? Is there one other person you can trust really deeply in your life? Are there two or three other people you can trust? Are there people in your life that you really, they're close to you, but you really distrust them? You don't feel like they have your best interest at heart. What about trusting relationships? Is that causing some distress in your life? What about not letting go? In some of our other classes, we've talked about everything I let go of has claw marks on it, huh? Some things we just won't let go. And people might say, let it go, man. Let it go. But it's like, no, I can't let go. I keep worrying about it, or I keep struggling about it, or I keep hitting my head up against a wall. So ask yourself right now, is there someone or something I need to let go of so I can have some serenity and peace of mind and some health? What about resentment? Resentment is a big cause of stress in our lives. Is there anyone today that you're resenting? Someone you're angry with? What about perfectionism? Are you perfectionistic toward yourself? And every time you make a mistake, you start beating yourself up. Or are you perfectionistic with your spouse or your children or your friends? You're always kind of nagging at them, and it's never good enough, and it can always be better. How's your self-esteem? Is that an area that's causing you stress in your life? Is that an issue that you want to work on in recovery? Is having a healthier sense of yourself and having good self-esteem? The next question, is there anybody or anything that you're afraid of right now? Is fear really upsetting your life? Is it causing stress? How are you doing with handling your feelings? Many of us, one of the number one or two or three things in our life when we get into recovery is we have to learn how to identify our feelings and then how to deal with them. Because so many of us, for so long, we pushed those feelings underwater, didn't we? We really didn't deal with our feelings. So how are you doing with letting that beach ball come up and learning to identify feelings and being able to communicate about your feelings and deal with them? What about your job or your career? How are you doing with that? Is that a source of stress or a source of distress in your life? Do you have a sense of meaning and purpose in your life? We go through times in our life where we're pretty clear about what's meaningful to us and what my life purpose is. And that feels really good to have that sense of direction, doesn't it, you guys? But other times in our life, it's like we're really lost and it's like, man, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing here on the planet. I'm not sure what's meaningful to me or what my life purpose is. And so that can be stressful. Now, again, all we need to do is search for meaning, like Dr. Frankl talked about in Man's Search for Meaning. If we're feeling lost or confused about our purpose, that's okay. We just need to have the courage to look, to search it out. And then we talked about this earlier. How are we doing with our idea and this concept of personal responsibility? That I'm responsible for my life. Maybe I'm not responsible for everything that's happened to me, but now that I'm here at this day in my life, and I'm 25, I'm 35, I'm 45, I'm 55, I'm 65 years old, I'm getting into recovery, what am I going to do? Because I'm responsible for my life now. Okay? So we just went through a whole list of things there, huh, you guys? About causes. And so hopefully you paid attention and maybe you're circling those. And you're willing to deal with those now in recovery. And say, I not only want to deal with my symptoms of stress, I want to deal with my causes of distress in my life. So now that we've taken a look at our symptoms and our causes, we want to say, and we've been saying, well, what can I do about this? Because we don't want to stay stuck in the problem. We want to get into the solution, don't we? So let's go ahead and talk about what's the solution. What can we do? So there's a list of things here, and we're going to walk through this. And I'd like you to check off with yourself and say, am I currently doing this? And if I am, great. Good for you. Did you used to do this and maybe you let it drop by the wayside? But as we walk through this, you say, you know what? That would be good if I started doing that again. Or maybe you've never thought about doing this, but as we go through this list, you say, wow, that's a great idea. I'm going to start doing that. Okay, now again, I also want to mention, change is difficult, isn't it? I want to just remind you of that. And when we're looking at making changes in our life, it's sometimes tempting to say, I'm going to start doing this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this. Because we're like inspired and we're motivated and we're ready to go. But a lot of times, you know, like my grandma used to say, your eyes are bigger than your stomach, huh? You're taking on too much. So all you'd really want to do when we go through this list is maybe just identify one or two or at the most three things. At the very most, one or two or three things, some positive changes you're going to make in your life, okay? But don't do more than that because it would really be too much and you could end up getting discouraged. And when we get discouraged, we say, oh, the heck with it. I'm going to quit doing it all. So just think about one or two or three things at the most. So, gosh, there's so much research. The first one up here, you guys, is exercise every day for 30 minutes. There's so much research that shows that if we exercise for 30 minutes every day, it reduces our stress, it reduces our anxiety, and it also reduces our depression. We feel better about ourselves, we feel stronger. So 30 minutes of exercise, that could be walking or bicycling, which are pretty simple things to do. It could be gardening. Now again, you don't have to be walking on a treadmill or walking at the gym. It could be walking around our neighborhood. It could be walking to the bus and back. But 30 minutes every day, kind of a brisk walk or bicycling or some of you are on Medicare. A lot of people on Medicare have free memberships at gyms now. You can do water aerobics or you can swim laps. So can you be doing 30 minutes a day of exercise? And it could be three times a day for 10 minutes. It doesn't have to be all at once either, Okay? But can you be doing that? If you do 30 minutes a day, you will feel stronger physically and mentally and emotionally. And again, it reduces our stress, our anxiety, and our depression. The next thing to the right, it says avoid self-medication. And what that means is if we're on medication from our doctors, we take it the way that our doctor told us to take it, and we don't use alcohol or marijuana or benzodiazepines or methamphetamine or heroin or even gambling. We don't use drugs to deal with our feelings. We avoid self-medication. The next thing is, are you getting proper sleep and are you doing everything you can do to help yourself? Most people need between 6 and 10 hours of sleep a night. And we all need to know how much sleep we get. Are you going to bed at the same time and waking up at the same time? Again, exercise is helpful. Are you listening to nice calming music? Don't watch disturbing television shows before you go to bed. Are you spending some time meditating or doing some breathing exercises before you sleep? Another thing that's really important during the day is don't take a nap during the day. That can really mess up our sleep cycle. So maybe you're saying, you know what, that would really help me if I got a better night's sleep, and so I'm going to start doing that. And then to the right of that, you know, there's that little thing. It says, are we having fun yet? Huh? Having fun in recovery is really important. So recovery is really serious, isn't it? But part of this serious business of recovery is having fun. What do you like to do to have fun? Now, again, some of us don't have any money to go to a movie or to go bowling or to go golfing or whatever we might like to do. So then we have to pick some things that don't cost any money, like playing cards or playing dominoes or sitting around and swapping stories with friends or walking along the Truckee River and watching the ducks and the geese and watching family. So what can you do to have some fun in your life? Next to that is meaningful work. We've talked about Viktor Frankl talking about creative values, where he says, what are you giving to life? So in your job, do you have a sense of meaning and purpose when you do your work? It's like, I'm contributing to life. Now, some of us may be out of work right now. Some of us, because of our disabilities, we may not be able to work. So if we can't work like at a job, what about the way that we're conducting our lives? Are we making a positive difference in our world with our family, with our friends, with people in our support groups? Are we kind? Are we generous? Are we compassionate? Or, again, some of us who may not be able to work, maybe we can do volunteer work. Maybe 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 hours a week, we can be helping seniors or children or people with disability, where we have a sense where I'm really contributing to life. That, again, we're talking about stress management strategies, aren't we? Having a sense of meaning is so important in life. The next one is, we talked about acceptance earlier. How are you doing today with accepting yourself just the way you are? None of us is perfect. We're all imperfect. It's like some people will say, God isn't finished with me yet, huh? So are you accepting yourself just the way you are? And are you also willing to grow and become the best human being you can be? The next one to the right of that, are you doing things in your life to help other people? One of the best things when we're suffering with a physical or mental illness, and those symptoms can be very painful and problematic, and we can tend to focus on that. One of the best things we can do to get out of our self-centeredness is to start thinking about other people and say, what can I do to make so-and-so's life better? So think about that, and what can you do to make other people's lives better? The next one is, don't rush around like chickens with your heads cut off, huh? Just doing one thing at a time, not trying to multitask. Keep it simple, chill out, calm down, one thing at a time. To the right about to the right of that, do you have somebody you can talk to? There is that old cliche that a problem shared is a problem cut in half, and a joy that's shared is a joy that's doubled. Do you have a counselor? Do you have a therapist? Do you have a service coordinator? Do you have a sponsor? Do you have a friend, a family member? Do you have a support group, a church group? Do you have people you can talk to share about the great things in your life, which makes them so much more beautiful? Or when you have troubles, do you have someone you can share with? Someone who can feel your pain and provide you with empathy and compassion and encouragement and support. The next one is, how is your diet? How is your nutrition? Are you eating healthy? The one next to that, there's a lot of research, you guys, that shows if we journal our thoughts and feelings for 10 minutes every day, and again, we don't have to make it look like we're English majors up at UNR, huh? Just bullet point, just write about what am I thinking, what am I feeling, what's going on in my life. There's a lot of research that shows there's less stress, less anxiety, and less depression if we journal for 10 or 15 minutes every day. The next one that kind of goes along with journaling, are you making a gratitude list every day? Let me ask you, have you made a gratitude list today? Real quick, let me ask you right now. You don't have to say it out loud. Just think to yourself, is there one thing that I'm grateful for today? Is there a second thing that I'm grateful for today? And then third, is there a third person or is there something else I'm grateful for today? So making a gratitude list every day can really help us with our stress. The next one is, can I say no when I need to say no? Some of us cause too much stress on ourselves because we're always saying yes to people and we can't say no. The next one is, and I know many of you are doing this in your life already, meditation and being mindful. Are you taking 5 or 10 minutes to meditate and do your breathing and get calm and get relaxed and get grounded and centered and balanced every day? That's a really important discipline. The next one says, if I'm upset today, ask myself, how important is this really? Here I am, I'm getting all upset, I'm getting all flustered and angry, and we ask ourselves then, how important is this really? Is this something I should just let go of and not get upset about it? Or maybe I need to do something about it, but I don't have to be upset to do it. The next one is letting go of wanting more stuff. The next one is taking a class to improve our lives. Listening to music. Some of us in this room, we love music, huh? Whether it's soul music, country music, rhythm and blues, rap, classical music, jazz. Listening to music, are you taking time to do that? Some of you are musicians. Are you taking the time to play music or to create some music? Some of you are artists. Are you taking time to do your art? Another thing, we talked about this earlier, and it's something that's free. Going for a walk along the river, going for a walk and listening to the birds or looking at beautiful Mother Nature. Are you taking time to do that? That's something that we can do. It takes a few minutes every day, or you can even take an hour or 2 hours every day, going for a nice walk or just sitting and watching life in front of us. This next one is, we talked about fear earlier in the class. This next one is the courage to change. Is there something in your life right now that you've been afraid of changing, but you know if you had the courage to make that change, your life would be better? Think about that real quick, okay? Is there something right now that if you had the courage to change and you made that change, you know your life would be better? If so, you might want to check that one. The next one is, we talked about this earlier, a pair of glasses. Do you need to change your perspective about your friend, your support group, about life, about yourself? Do you need to change your perspective on anything right now? And then the last two things, is there someone you need to forgive? Do you need to forgive yourself or a family member or a friend or someone that you used to work with? Someone that hurts you? Do you realize that that's causing you stress in your life right now? And are you willing to forgive them? In the forgiveness talk, in the presentation, we talked about how forgiveness is not a feeling, it's a decision. And we can decide right now to say, I'm going to forgive so-and-so for what they did to me. And then lastly, is making amends. Holding on to guilt is very stressful, isn't it? So if we go back, is there somebody that we need to apologize to? We need to go back to them and say, I know I hurt you. I apologize. I'm really sorry. What can I do to make it up to you? And I promise you, I'll do my best to not make this mistake again. Can you find it in your heart to forgive me? And when we can go back to someone and say that, we have so much less stress. So lastly, let's take a look at this vision, decision, and action. This vision for this new life you want to have. Number one, can you identify one change you're going to make in this next week? Number two, do you need resources to make this change? Do you need to talk with your counselor? Do you need to journal? Do you need a couple of bucks to go do this? What resources do you need to make this change? Number three, is there anything that could keep you from making this positive change in your life? What will hold you back? So you've identified something as being really good. What will hold you back from doing it? Identify that. And then lastly, once you've decided and you've started doing it, what can you do to keep doing this? What can you do to encourage yourself and support yourself in making these positive changes in your life? So before you leave this class, or maybe right after class, maybe it's too quick, maybe later today or tonight or tomorrow, you'll spend a few minutes going back through this handout and then down at the bottom to identify what change you want to make, what resources you need, what can hold you back, and how can you keep yourself going? So in wrapping up our class today, we talked about this gigantic affirmation that I can live a vital and meaningful life. We talked about how we need to have resilient, we need to be resilient, and we need to have stress hardiness to deal with the slings and arrows of outrageous life. We talked about the principles of ACT. We talked about symptoms. We talked about causes and how we need to identify the causes and deal with that. And then all of these things that we talked about are low cost and no cost. They're low cost and no cost. So cost should not hold us back from making these positive changes in our life. So as always, it's been a great honor to spend this time talking with you about this really important topic. And as you continue your life journey, I wish you all the very best and take good care of yourselves, okay?